Morning. Good morning and welcome to Midrand Chapel. We're on load shedding at the moment. That's the reason there are only a few lights on, so we've got power for the music and worship team. So you'll have to just recognize your fellow members by broad outline as opposed to fine detail, because it's a little bit dark to see that fine detail. It might be a test of how well you know them if you can see them from that broad outline. Just a couple of things as we start off the service. We do still need to observe COVID protocols, so we do need to wear masks, we do need to observe social distancing, and we need to be mindful of hand sanitizing and washing as well. We need to, despite it being windy and there's quite a draft coming through, we do need to keep windows and doors open as well for air circulation. So please bear with us. It's for all of our protection. Okay, I'd like to, in starting our service, read Psalm 145. Is it that dark? Psalm 145, verses 1 to 2. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. And part of our meeting on a Sunday in worship is praising His name, bringing our time, bringing our sacrifices to Him, learning more about Him, learning how to live according to His purpose. So let me just pray for the service. Let's pray. Father God, we just thank you that we can meet today, that we can meet together here at Midrand Chapel, Lord. We just thank you that we don't have such strict restrictions anymore and we can meet in person, Father. Father, we come before you today to worship you, to praise your name, to learn more about you, to glorify you, Lord. And Lord, I just pray that every part of this service, the singing of choruses, the reading of Scripture, the teaching from Scripture, would just be a sweet sound to you, Lord, would glorify you, and Lord, would just allow us and challenge us to live lives for you and your purpose. Thank you, Father. Amen. Okay, let's go to the bulletin that's been pre-recorded. If you'd like to just get that bulletin going, please. Thanks. Thank you. Okay, thank you for the bulletin. Just a couple of things I'd like to just bring to your attention that were in those bulletins. The one item is prayer. I'd really encourage you to sign on. There is a link and there's prayer on Zoom. I think this Sunday it's here at church as well. And I'd really encourage you to be part of that prayer time. We need to be a praying church. We need to be praying people. And it's just an opportunity to pray with others. I'd also encourage you at 8 o'clock every Sunday morning before the service, we do meet for prayer in the youth hall, in the smaller hall there. And I'd encourage you to be there as part of that service. We pray from 8 until 8:20, then at 20 past 8 we come back into the hall. And I'd also ask you, as we come to church on a Sunday, from 20 past 8 to half past 8, if we can just cut down on conversation in the church and greeting, let's rather greet outside and spend the time from 20 past 8 to half past 8 just preparing ourselves for service, preparing ourselves for that incredible time that God is really in our presence, in our midst during a service. And then the other you would have seen on the last item on the bulletin, there is a weekly window which goes out by email. If you're not receiving that, please let Shirley know at the church as well. And also there is a virtual church WhatsApp group. If you're not on that and getting in news of the church, please let us know after the service so that we can make sure that you are added to that as well. Okay, let's stand and sing together. Two choruses, a hymn, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. And then after that, a chorus, We Fall Down. Let's sing together.
Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him, praise Him.
And if you'd like to take your seats, and Pravin's going to be reading scripture for us, if you'd like to go come up. But while he comes up, if you have not received a visitor's card and you're visiting for the first time, or if you never completed one, please would you raise your hand. I'm not going to call on you to introduce yourself or anything like that, just so that the stewards can give you a visitor's card. And then once you've completed it, if you could just place it on the table at the entrance when you go out. Thanks very much. Thank you, Pravin.
Good morning. Scripture is reading from Genesis chapter 34, from 1 to 31. Now Dinah, the daughter of Leah, whom she had born to Jacob, went out to see the woman of the land. And when Shechem, the son of Hamor, the Hivite, the prince of the land, saw her, he seized her and lay with her and humiliated her. And his soul was drawn to Dinah, the daughter of Jacob. He loved the young woman and spoke tenderly to her. So Shechem said to his father Hamor, saying, "Get me this girl for my wife." Now Jacob heard that he had defiled his daughter Dinah. But the sons were with his livestock in the field. So Jacob held his peace until they came. And Hamor, the father of Shechem, went out to Jacob to speak with him. The sons of Jacob had come in from the field as soon as they heard of it. And the men were indignant and very angry because he had done an outrageous thing in Israel by lying with Jacob's daughter, for such a thing must not be done. But Hamor spoke with them, saying, "The soul of my son Shechem longs for your daughter. Please give her to him to be his wife. Make marriages with us. Give us your daughters to us, and take our daughters for yourselves. You shall dwell with us. The land shall be open to you. Dwell and trade in it, and get property in it." Shechem also said to his father, to her father and to her brothers, "Let me find favor in your eyes, and whatever you say to me, I will give. Ask me for a bride price and gift as you will, and I will give whatever you say to me. Only give me the young woman to be my wife." The sons of Jacob answered Shechem and his father Hamor deceitfully because he had defiled their sister Dinah. They said to them, "We cannot do such a thing to give our sister to one who is uncircumcised. That would be a disgrace to us. Only on condition we will agree with you that you will become as we are by every male among you being circumcised. Then we will give our daughters to you, and we will take your daughters to ourselves, and we will dwell with you and become one people. But if you will not listen to us and be circumcised, we will take our daughter and we will be gone." Their words pleased Hamor and Hamor's son Shechem, and the young man did not delay to do the thing because he delighted in Jacob's daughter. Now he was the most honored of all his father's house. So Hamor and his son Shechem came to the gate of their city and spoke to the men of the city, saying, "These men are at peace with us. Let them dwell in the land and trade in it. For behold, the land is large enough for them. Let us take their daughters as wives, and let us give our daughters. Only on this condition will the men agree to dwell with us, to become one people. When every male among us is circumcised, as they are circumcised, will not their livestock and their property and all their beasts be ours? Only let us agree with them, and they will dwell with us." And all who went out of the gate of the city listened to Hamor and his son Shechem. And every male was circumcised, all who went out of the gate of the city. On the third day, while they were still sore, the sons of Jacob, Simeon and Levi, Dinah's brothers, took their swords and came against the city while it felt secure and killed all the males. They killed Hamor and his son Shechem with the sword and took Dinah out of Shechem's house and went away. The sons of Jacob came upon the slain and plundered the city because they had defiled their sister. They took their flocks and their herds, their donkeys, and whatever was in the city and in the field, all their wealth, all their little ones and their wives, all that was in their houses, they captured and plundered. Then Jacob said to Simeon and Levi, "You have brought trouble on me by making me stink to the inhabitants of the land, the Canaanites and the Perizzites. My numbers are few, and if they gather themselves against me and attack me, I shall be destroyed, both I and my household." But they said, "Should he treat our sister like a prostitute?" Thank you.
Glory be to God for his word. Let's go into a time of corporate prayer. Let's pray together. Father God, you are just such a mighty God. You're an infinite God. Father, it's just so difficult to even itemize and understand your attributes. You are omnipresent. You hold all in your hands, Lord. Lord, you control everything. You are the creator. You just created such an amazing world and such amazing creatures in it, and created us as men in your own image, Lord. And Father, you had a plan for us as mankind, a plan which involved sending your Son to be as man, but to be sinless, and to die a horrible death on the cross to pay the price for our sins as sinful man. And you did that, Lord, so that we could live forever with you. We could live in eternity with you. What a mighty God you are. And Father, we just pray for all churches that are meeting in your name today, Lord, all over the world. And coming closer to home, we pray for the Solar Five churches, Lord. We just thank you for that association of churches that really do focus on your scripture and understanding the word and the truth of the word. And Father, we think of the churches with which we are more closely involved as well. We pray for Crystal Park Baptist and their service today, for Richards Bay Church, for the church at Molotsani, Lord. We just bring them before you, and Lord, pray that you would be glorified through their services. We pray that you would be bringing visitors to them, that you would be, Lord, they would encounter the truth of your gospel, that they would make commitments for you, Lord. We pray that their members would be growing in maturity in you for your glory, Lord. And Father, we pray for all the visitors to Midrand Chapel. We just think of the many that have come to Midrand Chapel through these difficult last 18 months of lockdown and restrictions, Lord. We pray for the new members that we've welcomed into Midrand Chapel, and we pray for those who are preparing for membership in Midrand Chapel as well, Lord. Father, I pray that we really would be a praying church. We would be a church that's practicing the one another's, that we would be reaching out to understand others, to understand their needs, to come alongside them in love and serve their needs. So I just commit Midrand Chapel and all its members to you, Father. I pray for the ministries of Midrand Chapel. I think of the children's ministry and Sunday school, the youth, the worship and the music team in worship, the hospitality teams that just welcome us every Sunday and provide for refreshments after the service as well, Lord. I pray for the Bible studies, and Lord, I pray for these new Bible studies that are just starting up now, Lord. I pray that you would bring Midrand Chapel members to those Bible studies, that each person, each of us, would be growing through those Bible studies. Father, I thank you for our teaching ministry, that we can just hear the truth of your scripture expounded upon and explained and examined week by week as well, Lord. Lord, I pray for our outreach to Kalfontein, Lord. We've been, Lord, you know, battling with the response there, Lord, and I pray that you would just open that up, that we really could be serving the students at Kalfontein and assisting them with their educational needs, but through that be a testimony to you and your glory and your love, Lord. And Father, I pray for members in Midrand Chapel. Father, there are just so many needs. We think of those that have health needs. Lord, I pray that you would just reach out to them, that you would provide for their medical care, that you would, Lord, bring them before the right doctors and physicians and attendants who could, Lord, just understand what the issues are and heal those. I think of those who are seeking employment, that have lost employment through retrenchment. Lord, that you would, as they search for employment, just open the right doors, that you would just strengthen them as they undertake interviews and as they do applications for employment, and that you would just be putting them in the right place, Father. And Father, I think of those who have their own businesses and are struggling as a result of the economic situation, Lord. I pray that you would just provide work for them, for their businesses, that you would grow their businesses, that they would flourish, Lord. And Father, we pray everything within your will. We know that you have a purpose, and Father, it's so difficult sometimes to understand that. So I pray that you would just give us patience, that you would give us wisdom, that you would, Lord, just be helping us to continually be focusing on you and your purposes. It's so easy when we have times of trouble to be focusing on ourselves, to, Lord, look at what we think are our needs. But you understand us far better than we understand ourselves. You know what we need, and Lord, you're a faithful God, and we just praise your name for that. So, Father, we just thank you that we can bring our prayers before you. Lord, we know that you can do all and everything without us. But Father, you covet our prayers. You ask us to be praying. You command us to be praying, Lord. And Father, I just pray that you would make us a praying church, that you would convict us of the need for prayer, and that we would be, Lord, coming to you as a God of first resort, not of last resort. That we would be seeking your face and seeking your purpose in everything that we undertake. Thank you, Father. Amen. Okay, and if you'd like to stand and sing, Thine Be the Glory.
Jesus meets us, risen from the tomb. church with gladness, hymns of triumph sing. For her Lord now liveth, death has lost its king. Thine be the glory, risen, conquering sun. Endless is the victory, for death is won. No more without thee, glorious Prince of life. Life is not without thee, us more than conquerors through thy deathless love. Lead us in thy triumph to thy home above. Thine be the glory, risen, conquering sun. Endless is the victory,
oh, okay, please take your seats. Well, rather sit on them, I suppose. Okay, just an update on a couple of ministry things. As you've seen, and you've probably seen the notices, we have reshuffled and reconstructed, I'm not sure what all the terms we could talk about redoing, the Bible studies. So please, if you have not linked into one of those Bible studies yet, please would you do so? I'd appreciate it. Then also, we, for some time, Carlin has been leading the music ministry, and in recognition of that, we are looking at inviting him to stand as a deacon of Midrand Chapel. And so, if you have any issues with that, please would you discuss that with Carlin and with the leadership of the church. So we just bring him before you as a candidate. Carlin, would you like to say anything about that? Should we have some public questions? Should we do like you know, they do for the judicial? No, we won't do that at all. Okay. No, but Carlin's done an incredible job leading the music team, and so we would really invite him become a deacon, but we bring it before you as a church that if there are any issues that you know, please take that up with Carlin or with the leadership of the church as well. Okay, childcare can be dismissed at that time. There's one going at least. Can, as childcare being dismissed, let me just pray for, before we sing "To God Be the Glory," let me pray. Chris will be coming up immediately after we sing for the teaching time. So let me just commit that teaching time to the Lord. Father God, we just thank you for Chris and the teaching at Midrand Chapel. We thank you for the work that Chris has already done in preparation of examining the scriptures, building his understanding of those scriptures, Lord, looking for the truth and your intent and your purpose in those scriptures. And Father, we just pray for this time as he brings the scripture before us, as Lord, that you would just open our hearts and minds to understand. And Lord, I pray that the truth of the scripture would change us, that we would open our wills to take action on what we learn from your word, Lord.
Open the life gate that all may go in. the Father, through Jesus the Son. Redemption, the precious of God, to every believer, the promise of God, the vilest offender who truly believes, the moment from Jesus the pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord.
Seated. Good morning from my side, and welcome to everyone. A special welcome to you if you're visiting us this morning. I saw Andani, so I know Livuani is visiting somewhere. Yeah, there you go. Welcome, Livuani. And anyone else visiting, welcome. It's Andani's fiance, so make sure you make a beeline for the man in red, and if you haven't met his fiance. But please do find somebody you don't know, and just welcome them, and take them to somebody you do know, introduce them, and that way they get to know other people. So that's really a ministry that you can do on a Sunday morning to one another. So. Nice to see you all. We're a little bit full, probably more full than we should be. I'm not going to ask any questions because of the power failure. The stream's not working to that side, so we can't send people that side. But I think with the kids out, maybe we're okay. Then I also mentioned in the virtual church, a lot of people have been speaking to me about education, because that's one of the things that COVID have really affected. Parents have found themselves homeschooling, many of them, and people are considering different schooling options now. There's been a lot of disruption at the schools, them trying to manage all the COVID restrictions. So people are asking questions. I think on the good side, many parents have been more involved or more aware of their children's education and the issues there than probably ever before. So we want to do a series for the next three Sunday seminaries, 10:30 to 11:30, a Sunday seminary. It's after tea and fellowship. And we just want to do a series on education, just helping you think through what is education, where does it fit in the role of parenting. What are different models available to parents to educate their children? Homeschooling, online schooling, public schooling, private schooling, Christian schooling, Christian schools. Thinking through the pros and cons of those, and then also just focusing the third week at homeschooling. Many of you are considering it, and just helping you think through what are some of the issues relating to that you should be aware of, and obviously allow some Q&A for that as well. So Sunday seminary, don't want to miss that, just to understand what that's all about. And then we've been working through the letter to the Romans. So we're up to Romans chapter 9. So you can turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 9. We've come to a section of Romans that unfolds for us what theologians call the doctrine of unconditional election. Such a shocking doctrine, even the sound system's objecting. One theologian called Wayne Grudem, he's defined unconditional election as follows. Election is an act of God before creation in which he chooses some people to be saved, not on account of any foreseen merit in them, but only because of his sovereign good pleasure. So we call it unconditional election because there are no conditions outside of God. There's no reasons or conditions or criteria that are the basis of God's selection or choice of some people to be saved and not others. And basically, what you should understand, there's two major views in Christianity of how God saves people. Two perspectives concerning the mechanisms by which God saves people, Arminianism and Calvinism. And these two positions have been held by good and godly men and women and churches for centuries, literally. And so we're not talking about a salvation issue. This is not something that we should call into question, whether it's someone saved and disassociate from fellowshipping with them and not try to work together with them because they hold a different view. But we do need to understand these two major views that, in a sense, distinguish how Christians understand God working out salvation. In Arminianism, God loves all people equally. And so he sends Christ to provide a way for them to be forgiven of their sins and reconciled to himself. What determines whether someone is saved or not is not the free will of God, but the free will of the individual who must decide to either accept or reject Christ. Because of this, God cannot do any more than make the offer of salvation and hope that a person will accept it so that he can save them. That's the Arminian view of salvation. In Calvinism, their view of salvation, God loves a select group of people in a way that he does not love all people. And so he sends Christ to provide a way for them to be forgiven of their sins and reconciled to himself. What determines whether someone is saved or not is the free will of God, who has decided to save them before they were even born. Because of this, every person is not free to either accept or reject Christ. Those whom God has chosen will inevitably choose to believe in Christ, and those whom God has not chosen will inevitably choose to reject Christ. So it's a doctrine that's surrounded by controversy. And let's just acknowledge, like I said, that there are good men and women and churches on both sides of this. Charles Wesley and the various Methodist churches that arose from his evangelism and teaching hold to Arminian view of salvation. Nazarene, Pentecostal, and many Baptist churches hold to Arminian view of God and of salvation. Some well-known Arminians, maybe you've heard of some of them, E.M. Bounds, A.W. Tozer, Billy Graham, Oswald Chambers, Vernon McGee, Ravi Zacharias, and James Dobson. On the other hand, Dutch Reformed churches, Reformed Baptists, Presbyterians, Lutherans, and Church of England, and some traditional Lutheran churches hold to this Reformed view or Calvinist view of salvation. Some well-known Calvinists would include St. Augustine, John Calvin, obviously John Piper, Mark Dever, R.C. Sproul, Charles Spurgeon, John MacArthur, and men like them. So men and women who hold their Arminian or their Calvinist view well are going to come very close to each other in their view of God and of salvation. Because both are acknowledging that God is sovereign. Both are acknowledging that God's will and man's will is involved in salvation. Both are acknowledging there's an element of mystery. And so a good Calvinist and a good Arminian are going to come very close to each other in trying to reconcile the biblical tension, as it were, between the will of God, God's divine freedom, and human freedom and human will. Having said that, I don't think that you can sit on the fence on this issue. You have to make a decision. You can wrestle with it, you can struggle, you can get emotional, or you can just try and avoid the whole thing and ignore it. But it is an important issue. Because ultimately, if you trace back the reason, the ultimate reason and cause for your salvation, it either rests in the will of God or the will of man. If you trace back the first cause, as it were, why is it that you came to be a Christian, that you are a Christian, that you believe in Jesus Christ? It will either be based on the free choice and decision of man or the free choice and decision of God. And so where you land is going to have a major impact on your view of God and His love for you. It's going to really change that. Dave Hunt is an Arminian. He wrote a book against Calvinists called What Love Is This? And the title alone tells you that he regards these two different views as a different understanding of God's love, and I agree with him. And he says this as he concludes the book: "My heart has been broken by Calvinism's misrepresentation of the God of the Bible, whom I love, and for the excuse this has given atheists not to believe in him. My sincere and earnest desire in writing this book has been to defend God's character against the libel that denies his love for all and insists that he does not make salvation available to all because he does not want all to be saved." And you can tell he feels strongly about this issue, and many people do. And though I don't agree with his position, I agree with his understanding that these two views give you a different understanding of God and His love and the way He works out salvation. And as I mentioned last week, it's important that we wrestle with what the Scriptures actually say, that we take our frameworks and our presuppositions and we let the text be king. Because all of us are going to come to the Scripture, come to the Bible with some preconceived ideas, some emotion, some perspective of how this works and who we think God is or should be. And we need to lay that down at the foot of the Scripture, because that is what sanctification is. Sanctification is conforming our thinking to God's thinking, our perspectives to God's perspectives, our lives to Him. We need to let God be who He is. And so my appeal is, as we come to this issue, is not to come to it saying, well, this is my position because of how I feel, or because of some experience I've had, or because of some Calvinist or Arminian I know that I think highly of or think poorly of. But let's just come and see, what does the Bible actually teach about this? The central tenets upon which Arminian theology is built are the following: God loves all people equally. Secondly, man's individual will is ultimately what determines whether God's good intentions for them are realized or not. Thirdly, it is not just or right for God to bend man's will to his own. And fourthly, God is not glorified by people going to hell. And I believe the passage we'll look at this morning demolishes every tenet of Arminian theology. I'll let you be the judge of that. So Romans 9:14. What shall we say then? Is there injustice on God's part? By no means. He says, is there injustice on God's part? Is God unjust? Is God unrighteous? Can God be accused of wrongdoing or wickedness? Has God done wrong? Now, what would lead Paul to say that? Why would he say, you know, has God done wrong then? Well, that's because of what he's just been saying, right? And what has he just been saying? He's just been making an argument that says God's plans and purposes towards Israel are not saved, even though many Israelites have rejected Christ. Because he always chooses some. He always, his perspective, his plan, his purpose was always to choose some from among the many descendants of Israel. He chose Ishmael and not Isaac and not Ishmael. And then in verse 13, the verse before this, he chose Jacob and not Esau. Verse 13, as it is written, Jacob I love, but Esau I've hated. And note how the text puts this. It's not this, I chose to love Jacob and I ignored Esau. No, there's an active decision, an action by God. I've loved Jacob and I've hated Esau. Is this not unjust and unfair on God's part? Does this not make God unrighteous? And the emphasis of the whole preceding passage is on God's sovereignty. God decided beforehand whom he would set his love upon and work out his plans of salvation and fulfill his promises and his covenants. And that's what he said in verse 11. Though they had not yet been born, who had done nothing, either good or bad, in order that God's purpose of election might continue, not because of works, but by him, because of him who calls. She was told, the older will serve the younger, as it is written, Jacob I loved, Esau I hated. Now you can see why this makes us unsettled, and we covered this last week. And it raises the question, is it right, is it fair for God to work out salvation this way? Can God exercise this kind of sovereign selecting to love some and draw some near to him and to hate others and to punish them? Is this right? Some try to argue from this passage that this is about God choosing nations and God giving blessing. It's about corporate election. It's not about individual salvation. But Paul has based his whole argument on the individuals that God has selected. Isaac and not Ishmael, Jacob and not Esau. Notice in chapter 9, verse 8, this means that it's not the children of the flesh who are the children of God, but the children of promise who are counted as offspring. So this is about who are the children of God are. This is not just about who gets blessing or who gets land. Who is the children of God? Notice verses 11 and 12, where it talks about that they have not yet been born and done and had done nothing either good or bad in order that God's purpose in election might continue, not because of works, but by him who calls. And that calling is the same word he used in 8:29, when it talked about God working all things together for good. For those whom he predestined, he called, he justified, he glorified. And that was all about this unbroken chain of salvation. And he picks up on this idea of calling again here in chapter 9 and verse 23, in order to make known the riches of his glory for vessels of mercy, which he prepared beforehand for glory, even us whom he has called, not from the Jews only, but also from the Gentiles. He's making the riches of his mercy known to us, those whom he called. What? Called unto salvation from among the Jews and the Gentiles. And if you look in chapter 9, verse 25, as indeed he says in Hosea, those who are not my people, I will call my people. And who are not beloved, I will call beloved. Those who are not his people and were not loved, he will call his people and he will call loved. This whole discussion is about, started because of the problem created. Why have so many Israelites not believed in Jesus Christ and been saved? Right, so that's just to settle in your mind that as we look at what this passage teaches, this is not just about corporate election. This is not just about deciding who will be blessed or who will get a promised land or not. This is about who will be called children of God, who will enter into love relationship with him, who will be glorified and spend eternity with him. Why is it that so many Israelites have not believed in Jesus? Because all along, God never chose every individual Israelite to be the recipient of his love and his saving purposes. Does God love all people equally? No. Does God choose to save all people? No. Jacob I loved, Esau I hated. What shall we say then? Is there injustice on God's part? Is this unfair? Can we accuse God of wrongdoing? This is not right, is it? And so Paul must affirm in the strongest possible terms, by no means. Don't even think that we can accuse God of wrongdoing. May it never be. And he goes on to provide an answer to this objection. So that's what we're going to be looking at this morning, verses 14 and following. His answer to this objection, which we all sense at a level, is it right? Is it good? Is it fitting that God choose to work out salvation in this way, by unconditional election? So let's read from verse 14 to 24, and then I'll unfold it for you. What shall we say then? Is there injustice on God's part? By no means. For he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. So then it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who has mercy. For the scripture says to Pharaoh, for this very purpose I have raised you up, that I might show my power in you, and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. So then he has mercy on whomever he wills, and he hardens whomever he wills. You will say to me then, why does he still find fault? For who can resist his will? But who are you, O man, to answer back to God? Will what is molded say to its molder, why have you made me like this? Has the potter no right over the clay to make out of the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another for dishonorable use? What if God, desiring to show his wrath and make known his power, has endured with much patience vessels of wrath prepared for destruction, in order to make known the riches of his glory for vessels of mercy, which he has prepared beforehand for glory, even us, whom he has called not from the Jews only, but also from the Gentiles. And we'll stop there. Note his argument in a nutshell. Is there injustice on God? His answer does not say God is not unjust because it was man's own choice to reject him. He doesn't say God is not unjust because it's not God's fault, it's man's fault. He doesn't say it's not unjust because though God really wanted to save all people, he simply couldn't because he was powerless to overcome the freedom of the human will and the rebellion of man. That's not at all how he goes about answering the question, is it unjust, is it unfair for God to save this way? No, he says God is the sovereign creator and owner, and he has the right to do with his creation whatever he so wills. And that is the bottom line of why we struggle with what this passage teaches. There is nothing in this text, to be completely honest with you, there is nothing in this text that is difficult to understand, but much that is difficult to accept. If we do not want to accept that God is God, and he can do whatever he so chooses. Once that's settled in our mind, then this is not actually difficult at all. But it is difficult. And so the first point that the text affirms here, God is sovereign in mercying. God is sovereign in mercying. Now, if you're wondering what I'm saying, you're right. There is no such English word as mercying. There's no verb. But there is in Greek a verb, a doing word, an action. And in the Greek, it's an action. God is sovereign in mercying and hardening. Both are active verbs in the text here. These are actions which God himself performs. He is the one doing these actions, the mercying. And mercy means not to treat someone as they deserve. So God has the sovereign right to choose not to treat someone as they deserve. That's what the text says. And the text presumes then that all men are in need of mercy. But God has the sovereign right to choose whom he mercies. And that's the argument that Romans has been painting from the beginning. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We are all rebellious and rightly deserving of his justice. There's not a man who can stand before God and say they are innocent and not deserving of judgment. Not a single one. That was the opening arguments of Romans. And then he quotes here. He says to Moses, I will have mercy, I will mercy whom I have whom I mercy, verse 15, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. And he's quoting from Exodus chapter 33 here. So it's helpful for us to just go back to that passage. So turn in your Bibles, keep your finger here. Let's go to Exodus 33, Genesis, Exodus, second book of the Bible. Context is God delivers them out of Egypt. They're on their way to the promised land. Moses goes up on the mountain to get the law from God. While he's up on the mountain, they're creating a golden calf and saying, this is the God that brought you out of Egypt. And God says to Moses, let them alone that I can destroy, let me alone that I can destroy them. And Moses intercedes and he says, but God, you chose these people. They are your offspring of Abraham. How can you do this? It's for your own glory that you do not destroy them. And so God relents. And then this is what he says to Moses in Exodus chapter 33, verse 17. The Lord said to Moses, this very thing that you have spoken I will do. He will forgive them. For you have found favor in my sight, and I know you by name. Moses said, please show me your glory. And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before you, and will proclaim before you my name, the Lord. And I will be gracious to whom I'll be gracious, and I will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. But he said, you cannot see my face, for man shall not see me and live. And then God hides him in the cleft of the rock, and he passes in front of him. And as he passes by him, he proclaims his name in Exodus 34, verse 5. The Lord descended in a cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, but who will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation. And Moses quickly bowed his head toward the earth and worshipped. The very name of God, God says, I'll proclaim my name to you, and I'll have mercy on whom I'll have mercy, and I'll have compassion on whom I'll have compassion. This is what it means to be God. This is the glory that is associated with God's name and his reputation and his honor, that he can mercy whomever he likes. And so he's granting Moses' request, but he wants Moses to understand he's under no obligation. I'll mercy, but you can't make me mercy, because it's my very nature to be slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. And this passage is quoted more than by the Old Testament more than any other passage, because it really defines who God is in his goodness. I'll make all my goodness pass before you. This is what makes God who he is. This is what his name stands for, his reputation and his glory. And this is what makes him good, that he is the sovereign of the universe who mercies whoever he wants. And he's slow to anger, and he's abounding in steadfast love, but he will not let sin go unpunished. When we raise the objection, this is not fair, the assumption is that God ought to mercy everyone. The assumption is that God is somehow obligated to forgive everyone. That is how we would define and describe God, a God who must show mercy to everyone. But that is not how God defines and describes himself. He is a God who's sovereign in mercying. It is his nature to be merciful, but not his obligation. And it is his sovereign right to mercy whomsoever he wills. He's in no way obligated to forgive or save anyone. If God shows mercy to anyone, it's his sovereign privilege, it's his goodness and his kindness. To pour out wrath, to judge sinners for their rebellion, to destroy a creation that rebelled against its creator, that is just and right, and God has every right to do that. To punish the wicked, that is justice. But mercy, that's according to his sovereign pleasure. That is what it means to be God. Mercy does not fall into the category of justice or obligation. And so we can't accuse God of being unjust or showing no mercy to all. And that's bound up in his very nature. So on whom does mercy depend? What is the basis or what is the grounds upon which God's mercy depends? If you go back to Romans chapter 9. I will have mercy, verse 15, on whom I mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will compassion. So then it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who has mercy. You see the contrast? What is the grounds upon which God's mercy depends? And he draws these things into two columns. Not on this, human will or human exertion, but on this, the mercy in God. The sovereign mercy of God, the privilege of God as God to show mercy, though he's not obligated to. God would be completely just to destroy every single person and annihilate his entire creation. And he could not be accused of an injustice. His sovereign right to mercy, and it's not dependent on him who wills or him who exerts or runs. The text says literally, it's not dependent on the will or the works of man. Do you get that? We've seen it's not dependent on the works of man. That's been the whole argument of Romans. Not by works, right? There's nothing that man can do to deserve or earn or merit God's mercy. And we were all fine with that argument. But now he adds another element. It's not on the basis of him who wills or him who works or exerts. It's not even on the basis of our will or desire. God is not obligated to show mercy because we desire it, though we don't. The ultimate grounds for God's mercy is not in man's will or man's desire or man's works or man's effort, but on the mercying God. Second facet to his argument, yeah, God is sovereign in hardening. If this was hard to accept, it's going to get harder. Verse 17, for the scripture says to Pharaoh, for this purpose I raised you up, that I might show my power in you, and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. So then he has on mercy on whomever he wills, and he has the second part, and he hardens whomever he wills. Notice how verse 17 begins, for, since, because. So he's carrying on his argument here. He's expanding on his point. He's giving further biblical evidence for the assertion that there's no injustice on God. And yeah, he says it's God's sovereign right to harden. Not only does God have the sovereign right to mercy, but God has the sovereign right to do the opposite, to harden. God is glorified or shown to be good. His character is put on display both by his mercying and his hardening. If mercy means that we do not treat someone as they deserve, then to harden means we do treat them as they deserve. To harden means to be stubborn or obstinate, to refuse to change one's attitude. And the idea here is not that God makes someone rebellious. It's not that God makes someone rebellious, which would make God the author of sin. But rather that he strengthens them and confirms them in their rebellion. Do you get that? The seed of rebellion is in man. God doesn't have to put it in there. The seed of rebellion is in man. That was the whole opening chapters of Romans. But God can strengthen us in our rebellion. Isn't that how Romans 1 began? Did you miss it? I mean, just go back there for a second. Keep your fingers here. Romans chapter 1, verse 18. Romans chapter 1, verse 18. The wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them. His invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made, so they are without excuse. Man cannot be excused for his rebellion. Although they knew God, They didn't honor him as God or give thanks to them, but they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened, and they exchanged the worship of God for the worship of creation. Therefore, verse 24, what did God do? God gave them up in the lusts of their heart. Therefore, what did God do? Verse 26, he gave them up to dishonorable passions. What did God do? Verse 28, since they didn't see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to debase mind. He hardened them. He confirmed them. He established them in their rebellion. Paul is drawing again from the Old Testament here. In Exodus chapter 9, it's helpful for you to just go there again. So let's go back to the narrative that he's drawing from in Exodus. Exodus chapter 4, if you start there, when God is revealing himself to Moses at the burning bush. Exodus 4:21. God is explaining what he's about to do. Deuteronomy. No wonder I'm struggling. Like, wow, I've written the wrong reference again. Exodus chapter 4, verse 21. And the Lord said to Moses, when you go back to Egypt, see that you do before Pharaoh all the miracles that I've put in your power. But I will harden his heart so that he will not let the people go. And then you shall say to Pharaoh, Thus says the Lord, Israel is my firstborn son. I say to you, let my son go, that he may serve me. If you refuse to let him go, behold, I will kill your firstborn son. This is how the whole narrative begins. I'm going to send you to Pharaoh, but I'm going to harden his heart that he will not listen. And then I'll bring my judgments upon them. And then if you turn over to chapter 9, this is the section he's quoting from, verse 13. Then the Lord said to Moses, rise up early in the morning, this is midway in the plagues, and present yourself before Pharaoh and say to him, thus says the Lord, the God of Hebrews, let my people go that they may serve me. For this time I will send all my plagues on you yourself and on your servants and your people so that you may know that there's none like me in all the earth. For by now I could have put out my hand and struck you and your people with pestilence, and you would have been cut off from the earth. But for this purpose I have raised you up, to show you my power, so that my name may be proclaimed in all the earth. And you are still exalting yourself against my people and will not let them go. Why did God raise Pharaoh up? This is what he's raising. This is the point that he's raising. Why did God raise Pharaoh up? Why did God harden his heart, confirm him in his rebellion, in order that he might demonstrate his power in judging Egypt, even as he demonstrated his power in delivering and mercying Israel? And both were demonstrated in the same act. The Exodus that the Jews celebrated was a celebration of God's deliverance from Egypt. But at the same time, God was executing a judgment on Egypt. And he was sovereign over both. That's Paul's point. Why would God do such a thing? Why would he create a Pharaoh? Why would he raise him up and bring him up to this position of power? God is in control of nations and kings. Why would he do it? Because he wants to demonstrate his power and his justice. And his power and justice and his nature and his glory is shown both in his mercying and his hardening. And the scripture says that God hardened Pharaoh's heart. You read it there in Exodus 4:21. Also says it in Exodus 7:3, Exodus 9:12. But the scripture also says that Pharaoh hardened his heart. Exodus 7:13, 8:32, 9:34. And this is where people become undone. Right? How does this work? How do we explain how the will of God and the will of man coexist and coincide with one another? It's revealed here that God sovereignly mercies some. It's his will to show mercy to some. It never contemplates the thought that man's will is not involved in that. And that's why the scriptures always appeal, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ that you might be saved. Our will, our decisions is involved in that. It assumes that we have rebellion, we have will to rebel against God, and we exercise that will in rebellion, and yet God shows us mercy in drawing us to himself that we might believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And his will and our will are both involved there. And likewise, when God hardens, that's his will to harden. But harden what? Harden people in their rebellion, and that assumes that we have a will to rebel against God. And so whenever you think about God's sovereignty exercising his will and man's responsibility, man exercising his will, the scripture never presents as God exercising his will so man has no will. It never presents that. In both hardening and mercying, we have a will. We have a decision. We have a response. But what is the ultimate cause that lies behind it? That's the question. When the scripture reveals that God hardens, Pharaoh also hardened. The seed of rebellion was there. God confirmed him in that rebellion. When the scripture reveals that God shows mercy on whomever he wills, we are the ones who will, who come, who hear the call, who respond and believe. But whose will is ultimate? Whose will lies behind that? Both wills are involved, right? So neither Arminianism nor Calvinism are trying to say that there is no human will or freedom. That is why God can hold us accountable and responsible for our decisions and why he can rightly judge us. Both sides acknowledge that. But whose will is ultimate in determining the outcome? That's where we differ. Calvinists say it's ultimately it's God's will. It's by God's will. And the Arminians say it's ultimately because of man's will. If we go to hell, it is solely because of our stubborn rebellion against God. We are completely at fault and rightfully judged. If we go to heaven, it's solely because God chose not to harden us, but to mercy us. And that tells you mercying is the opposite of hardening. Instead of confirming in your rebellion, leaving you in your rebellion, strengthening you in your rebellion, he turns you from your rebellion. He softens your hardened heart. He turns you away from unbelief to believe in Jesus Christ. That's what mercying is all about. Turning your will, bending your will to his will and his purpose. Softening your heart that you might believe and obey. The verbs in this passage are both active. And so the primary emphasis on this passage is not on what man wills or man does, but what on God wills and God does. That's what it says. He mercies on whomever he wills, verse 18, and he hardens whomever he wills. And that's why some of us will say in verse 19, why does he still find fault? Who can resist his will? Someone will say, well, if God's will is ultimate, then where does that leave me? Is my will irrelevant? How can I resist his will? That's exactly the objection that he's going to deal with. And that's where he ends. Sovereign ownership. Sovereign mercying. Sovereign hardening. Finally, sovereign ownership. Verse 20 says, who are you, O man, to answer back to God? Well, what is molded, say to its molder, why have you made me like this? Has the potter no right over the clay to make out the same lump, one vessel for honorable use and another for dishonorable? You can see the tone of his answer here. Do you realize your place? As one writer explains it, the objection here doesn't represent a humble attempt to puzzle out the relationship between divine sovereignty and human freedom. Right, there is a mystery there. There is a puzzle there. There is a difficulty there. Our will is affirmed, our responsibility, and that's why God can judge us. But God's will is ultimate. And there is a mystery there, but that's not what's reflected in this text. The humble puzzling out of this. The objection manifests a rebellious spirit that refuses to countenance a world in which God is absolutely sovereign and human beings are still responsible. We don't want to live in that kind of world. That's our rebellion. The opponents dig in their feet by insisting that if God decides whom to harden and whom to give mercy, then it is nonsense to hold human beings responsible for their actions. And that's why he goes on to explain, Paul's response to the protester then is this: how can finite, frail, and weak human beings venture to dictate to God how the world should be run? Who do we think we are to presume to call God to account and to pass judgment on him? That's how God has revealed himself to be. This is my name. This is my glory. I'll harden whomever I will, and I'll mercy whomever I will. And our will is involved in both. But God's will is ultimate. And that's his sovereign right. And he uses the picture here of the potter and the clay. He says, listen, you like clay. God is just molding you and making you for whatever purpose he so chooses. And that clay has no decision in that. The ultimate decision lies with God of what he's going to do with this clay that he's molding. He's the creator and he has the right and authority to do with us whatever he wants. And our problem comes when we draw an analogy between us and God. And we think like God and we think we like God. Instead of going, he is God and we are man. You see, there's a bunch of things that God has the right to do and God alone has the right to do. God premeditates to kill people. No human being has the right to do that. God chooses to bring people into this world maimed and blind and deaf. And we would never choose to do that. God called the Israelites to go into cities and destroy every living person, men, women, children, as an expression of his judgment. No human being who does that would be regarded as good. But we can't put God on our plane and make him play by our ethics. He is God and we are man. He is creator. And when he puts someone to death, it's his sovereign right to do that because he created, he gives life, he sustains life. We do not. That's the big problem here. When we err, it's because we set ourselves up as a judge of God and we sit in judgment of his will and his ways rather than God be the sovereign judge of our wills and our ways. The central tenets upon which Arminian theology are built are the following. God loves all people equally. Jacob I loved, Esau I hated. Man's individual will is ultimately what determines whether God's good intentions for them are realized or not. Text says, it is not the one who wills or works, but on the mercy in God. It is not just or right for God to bend man's will to his own. The text says, I will mercy whom I mercy, and I will harden whom I harden. And he bends our will accordingly. Fourthly, God is not glorified by people going to hell. And we'll deal with that next week. Because we've had quite enough. But let me leave you with a thought. To maybe encourage you and soften the blow, and a quote from Spurgeon. He has the thought, if God's love for me doesn't ultimately lie behind my choice to believe and follow Jesus Christ, then the only other option is that it's my love for God. Do you get that? If God's unconditional love for me doesn't ultimately lie behind my choice to believe in and follow Jesus Christ. The only other option is that it's my love for him that lies behind it. And that is a far more terrifying proposition. I would far rather that my relationship with God and my eternal destiny be secured by inexplicable, indefatigable, unchanging divine love and purpose than by my feeble and fickle human love and decision. That's honestly how I feel. If you give me the choice, just personally, emotionally, once I've worked through all the turmoil, what would you have your salvation ultimately depend on? God's inexplicable love for you. Why you and not others? Who knows? Would you rather have it be based on that or on your love for him, which is always fickle and changing? And so Charles Spurgeon says this, "I know nothing again that is more humbling for us than this doctrine of election. I've sometimes fallen prostrate before it when endeavoring to understand it. I've stretched my wings and eagle-like I soared toward the sun. Steady has been my eye and true my wing for a season. But when I came near it and the one thought possessed me, God has from the beginning chosen you unto salvation. I was lost in its luster. I was staggered with the mighty thought. And from the dizzy elevation down came my soul, prostrate and broken, saying, Lord, I am nothing. I am less than nothing. Why me? Why me?" Friends, if you want to be humbled, study election. For it will make you humble under the influence of God's Spirit. He who is proud of his election is not elect. And he who is humbled under a sense of it may believe that he is. He has every reason to believe that he is. For it is one of the most blessed effects of election that it helps us to humble ourselves before God. So we're going to close in a song. I just want to encourage you to use this as to humble yourself before God. And if you're wrestling with this doctrine and this is new to you and difficult for you, just keep looking at the text and keeping asking God to give you a right heart before him. Let's stand together.
Always see how great, how great.
Father, we thank you for your word, and we praise you for your sovereign grace, sovereign in mercy, sovereign in hardening, sovereign ownership. You are the potter and we are the clay. You are the wise and holy and good God, and we are the wicked, rebellious, selfish, ignorant children on whom you have shown mercy, undeserved, uncalled for, unmerited, sovereignly, because of nothing in us, but everything because of who you are. And Father, a part of us says, why? Why me? And we grope to understand, Lord, is there something in me? But Lord, we'll never find it. We praise you that your decision to mercy lies within you and your sovereign choice, and we will never understand it. Father, I must confess that this has become a glorious reality for me. Your sovereign grace, your unconditional love, which is unchanging and undeserved, which is the source and fountain of my salvation and my faith in Jesus Christ. And all your plans and purposes are wholly good, and who are we to ever accuse you of wrongdoing? Father, I pray for those who are still in this process of wrestling with your sovereignty and trying to get their head around this doctrine and how it works. And Lord, on an emotional level, Lord, it's distasteful for them. It's odious, it's difficult, it's painful, and they weep, even as I've wept. Father, soften their heart, open their eyes, and show them your glory and your goodness. Proclaim to them your name, a God who is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love, but who will by no means clear the guilty. A God who is sovereign in mercy, and please, Lord, show them who you are, that they might delight in you. Father, forgive us when we take this doctrine for granted, and we reduce you to our level, and we make your answer to us and our thinking. Forgive us when we are proud and arrogant, when in reality, Lord, we are no different to anyone else that will spend eternity in hell, except that you set your love upon us. Forgive us, Lord, when we are self-righteous and condemning of others. Forgive us when we lack zeal to proclaim a gospel to a world where there are still your elect who are just waiting to hear that they might run to Jesus Christ. Forgive us when we don't believe in your power to save and don't accept your sovereignty in who you save. Thank you for teaching us this morning. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Right, please do stay. I think they're doing their best to have some refreshments. There's all kinds of eats and there's water. We can definitely have that. Hot water, I don't know. But please stay and enjoy the fellowship.